The war in Afghanistan claimed the lives of 158 Canadian soldiers from 2001 to 2014. In the Korean War, 516 died and there were 1558 casualties. In World War I, out of the 619,000 soldiers who served, 61,000 died, with 17,200 wounded. In World War II, there were 45,400 Canadians who died, but that is Canadians. To understand these numbers, we need to put this in perspective. In 1940, the world's population was 2.3 billion people. 3% of the population died due to World War II. So when we listen to the news, we often hear of bombs going off and killing dozens of soldiers, civilians. And when we name the first dozen as children, women, and men caught in the crossfire, we often stop to think and have a different perspective. One is a person that we know. 100 are many that we do not. There seems to be war on different fronts and in different places at any given time in our world. But do we pay attention to the details? Or merely read and hear the headlines and move on to something else? Is it because we don't want to talk about what is occurring, or we don't wish to face up to the fact that people are still dying or becoming wounded because of war, acts, terrorism, and aggression? What causes us to notice? Is it just too much information? Or is it because this information does not pull upon our own emotional strings? Or do we now live with hardened hearts regarding the world at war? Are we just missing the point and purpose of war at all? Terrorism is on a different plane than war throughout history. Wars and battles have modified what it means to turn on enemies and strike those who are against us. Are we willing to let this happen? Or are we lost in the details? I thank Ron for sharing in our reading from Haggai. In that particular reading, there's a lot of words that are more difficult to say than others. Names of people and individuals and situations and towns and sons of relationships. In this prophecy, Haggai received from God about the rebuilding of the temple or synagogue. Zerubbabel, son of Shealtiel and governor of Judah, as well as Joshua, son of Jehozadak, the high priest, and it is to these people that Haggai talks to and speaks to about receiving instruction from God. Haggai's message to these people is not about the actual building of the temple, but what he is to tell them is to enable them to carry on. They are to be strong in the Lord, to be strong in faith. God was not watching how elaborate the temple was as it was being built, but merely watched the people and sees that they're forgetting the spirit which remains with them. Because it is God to tell Haggai that God will shake the nations and will fill his house with glory. Silver and gold that are his will become even more glorious in this new temple. And why is this so important to God and the people? Because Haggai received this message about the temple. It is in this place I will bring peace. How many of you heard that part in the reading of today? All about the temple. For it is in this place God will bring peace. I ask that question because often we just get something on the names and the places and where people are talking to Haggai, we see all those different things. And then what happens is that we lose the purpose of what God is building this temple. Today we have so much information at our fingertips that information overload is like this highly probable. Sometimes we get tired of seeing the same public faces of politics, of entertainment, and even of sports. We get lost as to who everyone is and what they have or not accomplished. Media sources want us to know more about what happened when all we need is a headline or nothing at all. How many of us are really interested in the details of another person's life when we ourselves are not? needy and talking with Jesus. And they're trying to trap Jesus in his teachings. They did not believe in the resurrection. That was one thing that was known. The Sadducees did not believe in the resurrection after death. And so they come to Jesus and they ask about one of Moses' laws, which required a man's brother to take his brother's place if the woman, the widow, was left childless. This is a law set up to ensure that the wife would not be left destitute or live on the street or at the hands of other people. So in this scenario, the Sadducees share with Jesus about the story of seven brothers. The first one marries and dies without children. So she marries the second brother and then in turn the third and fourth. Right through, again, to all the time, all the brothers die. And they mention the woman does. The question the Sadducees ask is, whose wife is she? But Jesus simply responds by saying, you don't believe in the resurrection at all, and this type of question is unreasonable for you. If you believe as I have taught, you would know that in the resurrection there will be no marriage or giving in marriage. There is no doubt that those who die from their earthly existence leave behind their body and become like angels where there is neither male nor female. Their spirit lives on. Sadducees didn't know what to say to that. It was a great answer. But Jesus gave this so that in the end he continued to teach a little bit more too, because he's talking about Moses. After all, Moses was a key figure in history for these people. They loved Moses' story because he's the one who led them to freedom. Moses was speaking to the burning bush and God called. God was called by Moses, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. Jesus answered the question, not as they thought he would, by giving out which husband would actually be the wife, a lone husband in the resurrection, but teaching them to understand the resurrection itself, and the fact that God is living and is the God of all who believe. Jesus doesn't get caught up in the words of the questioning Sadducees, but uses the moment to teach what they obviously did not know. The resurrection means that all are alive in God if one believes, that God's children will become like angels and they will live forever with God. Jesus is not lost in the details of what they're trying to do, that is to trick them up, and he knew that they were trying to set a trap for him. But he answers with the words that they need to hear. Well, what are the words that we need to hear today so that we don't get lost in all the media and all the world details of all these stories of all in our world. Think about all the statistics and the gossip information that we hear and know about. Aren't we glad the election for the Americans is on Tuesday? And we don't. But we will never know what all the details are and what is the truth. We just hear social media attacking. What is it that God calls us to at this time? Paul's second letter to the Thessalonians gives us some insight for us today. We're remember that our faith is in Jesus Christ, and it is through